My talk today is, will be about the ESHRE guidelines on different types of pretreatment in ART cycles. To start with, why did I prefer to be an assisted reproduction specialist? Because it combines being science and an art. It's really an art. It's assisted reproduction and it's an art. Very seldom we see two patients who are alike, who are the same. Our patients are different patients regarding age, body mass index, intrafollicular count. So we need to individualize for each patient and her own strategy of treatment. Each ART consultant would always like to think that his own recipe of pre-treatment and the treatment adjuvant is what gives him or her an edge and what and it is the cause of his success. However, this might not always be true. We need to work on an evidence-based ground. So the answer, the question we want to answer today is, does hormonal pretreatment improve cycle efficacy and safety for ovarian stimulation, yes or no? The aim of hormonal pretreatment is to suppress or reduce FSH secretion prior to gonadotropin stimulation in IVF cycle. Let's all please look at this fine graph showing the FSH level all through the menstrual cycle. At the end of the luteal phase, there is a sharp rise in the FSH level. This FSH level increases might be due to iron level or decrease in inhibin level, whatsoever the cause, but there is a sharp rise in the FSH level. These rise work on different cohort of follicles at the end of the luteal phase. These cohort of follicles have different FSH receptor concentrations, so the response of them will be different. When the cycle occurs and we are starting stimulation in the next follicular phase, we will be faced with different cohort oocytes at different phases of maturation. So the response to gonadotropin stimulation will be different. So the stimulation will be asynchronous. The follicles will be asynchronous. And this is a large problem that we face when we are going to give the HCG treatment, trigger of ovulation. So if the hormonal pre-treatment can cause coordination of the early antral follicles, causing less size and of variability, and less discordant maturation of follicles, and hence easier clinical criteria for HCG administration, this would theoretically lead to more mature oocytes and more good quality embryos. That's why, or that is the purpose we might use pre-treatment. It would go, will lead to synchronization of follicular development, prevention of occurrence of early large follicles, prevention of spontaneous premature LH surge, reduction of cyst formation. Last but not the least, it's very important for scheduling IVF cycles. It's very important for the practitioners, for the embryologist, and even for the patients to avoid working or doing ovum pickup at weekends. Pre-treatment therapies might include estrogen pre-treatment, progesterone, COCs, and GnRH antagonist pre-treatment, as we might see. Starting with estrogen pre-treatment, the ESHRE guideline groups focused on a Cochrane database review that was conducted in 2017 by a group of clinicians from New Zealand and Australia. Regarding the estrogen pretreatment, they included four RCTs, including 744 women. The conclusion of this Cochrane review was that estrogen pretreatment significantly led to more oocyte yield than the group of no intervention, than the group which didn't take estrogen pretreatment. However, there was no difference between both groups in the rate of live birth rate or ongoing pregnancy rate or clinical pregnancy rate. As we all know, the live birth rate is the main determinant or the most important outcome for us. So the estrogen pretreatment, although it increased the number of oocyte yield, yet there is no difference in the live birth rate. ESHRE guideline reviewed another article, another randomized control trial that was published in 2018 by an Iranian group that wasn't published in the Cochrane database review. These are 30 women and compared estrogen pretreatment with no pretreatment. There was no difference in clinical pregnancy rate or number of mature oocytes retrieved. So the consensus of the ESHRE guideline development group was that pretreatment with estrogen before ovarian stimulation in the antagonist protocol is probably not recommended for improving efficacy and safety. Now moving to progesterone pretreatment, and again, they depended on the same Cochrane review database. They included four randomized control trials, 421 women, and they compared agonist cycles and antagonist cycles. As regarding agonist cycle, progesterone pretreatment, when compared with no intervention, there was no difference between both groups in live birth rate or ongoing pregnancy rate. However, in the antagonist cycle, there was insufficient evidence to conclude anything. There was not enough data to conclude anything. So the progesterone pretreatment in the agonist cycle, there is no difference, while in the antagonist cycle, there is insufficient data to reach a consensus. Hence, again, the consensus of the ESHRE guideline development group was that pretreatment with progesterone before ovarian stimulation is probably not recommended for improving efficacy and safety. But here there is a very important trick because this guideline development group acknowledges that estrogen and progesterone are widely used for scheduling purposes, and this is probably accepted. So we can use estrogen or progesterone for scheduling purposes. They accept this, but we cannot use them in the view that will increase safety or efficiency of our IVF cycle. Now, moving to the most important and most commonly practiced maneuver in our practice is use of pretreatment with combined oral contraceptive pills. Again, this concurrent systematic review conducted with compared 6 randomized controlled trials, and it has reached a very important consensus. In the antagonist protocol, pretreatment with oral will lead to a lower or less rate of live birth rate and ongoing pregnancies. And this is a strong evidence. There is no difference in ovarian nor in the number of oocyte rate. In my own practice, I used to use pills before any antagonist cycle for years, for ages. And I thought that this is a good practice. However, I changed my practice a few years ago, 3 to 5 years ago, and I no more prescribe oral contraceptive pills before antagonist cycles. However, there might be a small window that we can use oral contraceptive pills before antagonist in poor responders. In this special subgroup, when they have done sub-analysis, there was no difference in live birth rate or ongoing pregnancy rate or number of oocytes. So it might be used in poor responders. Again, as a trial came from the same Iranian group later after the Cochrane database review, and they found contraceptive pills. Hence, the ISHRI guideline development group, they conclude.
Could you repeat the last word, please? Because the connection is lost.
Okay.
Thank you.
The Iranian group published in 2018 another study comparing two groups, one with oral contraceptive pretreatment, the other with no oral contraceptive pretreatment, and there was no significant difference in clinical pregnancy or number of mature oocytes retrieved. Hence, the ISHRI guideline development group concluded that COC antagonist cycle is not recommended at all because of reduced efficacy, and this is a strong recommendation. However, we must put some certain points. All the studies we have talked about, they have heterogeneous types of estrogen and progesterone. They were not using the same types of estrogen or progesterone. Again, they used them for heterogeneous duration. Some studies used OCPs for 12 days, others for 21 days, others for 28 days. Again, there was a heterogeneous washout period. By washout period, we mean the period between stopping the oral contraceptive pills and the start of our HMG stimulation. Some studies started it 1 day after, and some studies started it 5 days after. If you use after five days, then we have adequate amount of time to let the FSH rise, and again we have the heterogeneity of follicles or the asynchrony of follicles. If we started the next day, 1 day only washout period, then the progesterone component in the oral contraceptive pills might be detrimental to the endometrium in the very, very early follicular phase. So again, the washout period was not homogeneous in all studies performed. This might be a future study. This area needs further studies again. Now moving to the antagonist pretreatment. In the hope of, again, for follicular synchronization, some groups started to use gonadotropin antagonist in the early follicular phase before starting the HMG induction of ovulation, aiming to suppress endogenous FSH and LH. So when we give the HMG induction, we would have synchronous follicles. Moving to the evidence regarding this in normal responders, there is very low quality evidence that ongoing pregnancy rate and number of oocytes are not statistically different. So in normal responders, this didn't show any effect or any difference. In poor responders, evidence still is controversial. Some studies show that this delayed start is beneficial, and some studies show that it's of no benefit. So the ISHRI guidelines group up till now concluded or recommended that GnRH antagonist pretreatment before ovarian stimulation, what we call delayed start gonadotropin, is probably not recommended. My take-home message is that pretreatment with either progesterone or estrogen is probably not recommended for improving efficacy or safety. Very important to know that oral contraceptive pretreatment is not recommended in the antagonist protocol because of reduced efficacy. guideline development group acknowledges that estrogen and progesterone are widely used for scheduling purpose, and this is probably accepted. Last, GnRH antagonist pretreatment before ovarian stimulation in delayed start gonadotropin protocol is probably not recommended. Thank you very much, and I'm wishing the EFRI best of luck in every webinar.